One of the most fantastic falsehoods that was reported in Turkey about tonight's speaker within weeks after he was imprisoned in October of 2016 was this. He was the mastermind of the July 2016 coup. If that coup against the government had succeeded, as its mastermind, his reward would be that he would become the next director of the Central Intelligence Agency. That's right, the CIA. So we think we've got problems with the media in our country. In the eyes of the media over there, the following is the path you take to get to the top of the Central Intelligence Agency. You get an undergraduate degree at Wheaton College. You get a couple of master's degrees from Trinity Evangelical Divinity School and Erskine Theological Seminary. Then you finish that off with a PhD at Aberdeen University in New Testament. My dear brother, I was so relieved yesterday when you were asked, what's on the horizon for you? You did not mention the CIA. My friends, it is with great joy and relief that I present to you a teaching elder of the Mid-Atlantic Presbytery of the Evangelical Presbyterian Church, the Reverend Dr. Andrew Brunson.
It took me many years to set up that very deep cover, you know. We are so grateful to the EPC in 2010. I was accepted by Mid-Atlantic Presbytery. It's been so very welcoming, and we're glad to be part of this family. I have very much wanted to speak on this subject to you. I think it's a very difficult subject, but I think that it's going to be increasingly difficult in the United States to stand for Jesus and for his truth. I have a sense of urgency. I've never had this for the United States. I've always been focused on the Muslim world, or at least for the last 26 years. But since I've come back to the States, there's just this urgency and weight on my heart that, because I think we're not prepared for what's coming. I'm not sure that my generation is ready, but especially the next generation, that's my children's generation, I'm pretty sure that they're not prepared. And we need to be aware of the signs of the time that we're living in. But I fear that many have become complacent, we're unaware, we don't expect it, and this means that people in our churches are going to be blindsided. So I want to speak about this to you especially because you're the ones who have the task of preparing the next generation. Persecution is nothing new, but for us in the U.S., I think it is. I remember when my mother visited me in the detention center early on in my detention, and she said to me, Andrew, there's a long line of people who've been persecuted for Jesus. It's a very long line that stretches back 2,000 years. My son, it's now your turn to stand in that line. Some of you are going to decide whether you will join that line as well. And I say there's an element of choice because persecution comes especially when we identify publicly with Jesus. I'm going to switch mics. So there is that element of choice. You can choose, in one sense, whether you will be exposed to persecution or not. One of the great challenges of our time is speaking truth. Everyone seems to be broadcasting their own truth. When I mean speaking truth is that we need to say about everything what God says about it. And this is where you're going to be challenged, and especially so in the areas of holiness and morality. There's a spiritual battle going on behind many of the issues of our day. Who is going to define truth? Who will define morality? Who will define identity? And God claims this right for himself. The Bible says that people will call what is evil good and what is good evil. And we're already seeing this, and I think it's going to get much worse. For those who stand for Jesus, there's a growing likelihood that society will marginalize them, look down on them, ridicule them. Maybe it will mean a loss of prestige, losing a job, and maybe even worse. And there's no way around it. Truth is offensive. And many take offense at Jesus, and there's clearly an attempt to silence his voice. And it's not enough that people will say you're wrong. That would be too easy. If only that were the extent of opposition. We disagree with you, you're wrong. But Jesus told us what's going to happen. People will say that you're evil. Jesus said in Matthew 5:11, blessed are you when people revile you and persecute you and falsely say all kinds of evil things about you on account of me. You know, Christians are the most loving, generous, and compassionate people in the world. But increasingly loud voices are blaring that Christians are actually hate-filled and bigoted and dangerous. I tasted a little bit of this from the media in Turkey. The coverage was just vile. They said I was a terrorist, that I hated Turks, that I was the head of the CIA in the Middle East. Other things like what Jeff said. They said I wanted to overturn the Turkish government, that I wanted to establish a Christian state by force. So they called me terrorist priest. Sometimes it was a whole front page of the newspaper. Spy priest. One of my favorites was Rambo priest. I was actually very frustrated. I wish they would accuse me of starting churches, accuse me of evangelizing Turks, accuse me of proclaiming Jesus. I would be proud of this. But they didn't do this. That would be too easy. Instead, I was dangerous. I was evil. I was a traitor. And because of this, I was despised and I was hated. And the government was intentionally pushing this wave of propaganda. Yes, they were doing it against me, but they were using me to paint all the other believers in Turkey with the same brush. So now, when persecution comes against the church, when there's violence against the church, against Christians, most Turks are going to say, well, they deserve it. So are you ready to be called evil? Are you ready to be despised, to be ridiculed, to be marginalized? Are the young people in your church prepared to stand when the Twitter mob attacks them? Are they willing to lose their jobs, to be denied degrees at the top universities? We need to have the right mentality. Jesus warns that persecution will come, that we need to prepare ourselves, that we need to have the right mindset for it. Early on in our first church plant, Noreen and I had to deal with some of this. We dealt with credible death threats for the first time. And we had to work through this. We had three young children. It was difficult emotionally for us. But we came to the decision, we will leave if you tell us to leave, God. We'll get on the next plane. But until you tell us to leave, then we will continue in our assignment, and we will trust that you will protect us. Except that we know that sometimes God doesn't protect, and he allows his children to be hurt. So if you allow that, we'll assume that you'll protect us unless it will bring you greater glory not to protect us. And so we went on that way, and there were a number of other threats that came throughout our years in Turkey. I was shot at once. We ministered near a war zone where there was risk, but we'd already worked through how to respond. So even though we had fear, sometimes we'd counted the cost. We were in a sense prepared. But I was not prepared for what I faced in prison. I hadn't counted the cost of this because it didn't happen in Turkey. If the government was upset with a foreigner, they would deport them. So prison was much more difficult than I would have guessed. And there are several reasons for this. There are several reasons why I broke so badly. I can't go into all of them, but one reason was because of wrong expectations. Some of it from wonderful Christian biographies. I talked a little about this yesterday. I had an idealized view of persecution, of suffering that comes from persecution. I thought I'd be filled with joy, that I would just have a sense of God's presence, that I would feel strong, that I'd feel such a grace just covering me. But this wasn't my experience. And I had to adjust my expectations. Now I'm going to do something that might frighten some of you. I'm going to dance. No. I had to adjust my expectations. In my second year in prison, I remember I read about Richard Wurmbrand, who a pastor in Romania who was held for 14 years in prison and tortured terribly. And he wrote about how, under the communist regime, and he wrote about how in solitary confinement, he remembered these words of Jesus, "Rejoice and be glad, rejoice and be glad, for great is your reward in heaven." And he began to leap around his cell. And I read this and I just felt such a sense of conviction because I had no joy. And I thought, this is a command from Jesus. He doesn't say, if you're happy and joyful, then rejoice. He says, no. He says, rejoice when people revile you and persecute you and say terrible things about you. Rejoice when you're persecuted. I thought, God, I have failed in this. I have not rejoiced. I have no joy in my life. And so I determined that I was going to dance. And I would start out and I'd say, Father, I repent. I confess that I have not had joy. I confess that I've been disobedient in this area and I ask you to forgive me. And now I'm going to perform an act of joy, even though I don't feel any joy. And I'm going to dance before you. And I begin to sing. What did I sing? I would sing, blessed am I when people revile me and persecute me and falsely say all kinds of evil things about me on account of you. Rejoice and be glad, for great is your reward in heaven, for in the same way they treated the prophets who came before you. I will dance as Rembrandt danced. I will leap as Rembrandt leaped. And I will dance around. And now I'll catch my breath in the Mile High City. I had to adjust my perspective and say, I submit this to you as an act of obedience, an act of love, an act of joy, even though I don't feel it. We need to teach that persecution is coming and how to stand when it does. Jesus warned that those who are not prepared for persecution, if you're not prepared, then you're surprised by it. And then you'll have a very difficult time and some will fail. I'm not saying that. Jesus said it. Jesus taught about the dangers of not being ready. One of the dangers is that many will be deceived. And I think by this he means that many will readily accept teaching. They'll look for teaching that will justify the compromise that will allow them to escape hardship. And certainly this was a problem in the early church. Jesus severely warns churches in Revelation because they have tolerated teaching that justified compromise. But there are some issues there. Do I offer incense to the Roman Empire? If I don't do this, they'll think that I'm a traitor, disloyal. Maybe they'll kill me. I don't really believe that he's a God. Why don't I go ahead and do it? Or what about work? Most people had to be part of a guild to work. And if you had to attend the ceremonies that the guild had, the feasts. If you don't go, then maybe you'll lose your job. Then you won't be able to support your family. But in these feasts, they have offerings to idols and they also have sexual immorality. Do I go? Do I not go? And so teachers arose who said, it's okay, don't worry.
notice that one of the main areas of compromise was sexual immorality. So the early church faced great pressure to compromise. And there were leaders, there were pastors, there were teachers who arose and justified taking the easy way out. And the heart of man is the same now as it was back then. Most of you who work in churches aren't going to go looking for people who are teaching the wrong thing. The temptation is that you will compromise your teaching. Last week, Noreen and I talked with Jack Phillips, the baker who's been persecuted because he won't make a cake to celebrate a gay wedding. He said that many Christians have been supported. There was something that really grabbed my attention because his lawyer was also sitting there, and he said that what really surprised him is that many pastors were not supportive, or rather, how few pastors did support him. Now, I'm not pushing for pastors to become culture warriors, but how many pastors are going to back away from standing for truth because they want to avoid controversy? Controversy outside the church and controversy inside the church. But if the pastor will not take risks to stand for truth, then how can we expect the people in the pews to stand for Jesus if it's going to cost them? So many will be deceived and many will be tempted to not teach the full truth. Another thing Jesus warned is that many will react from fear. And I know what fear is. I had faced danger before in my ministry, but I was overwhelmed in prison. I was so afraid that I would not be with my children again, that I'd never see my wife, that I'd wither away and die in a Turkish prison in terrible isolation. I think of an example. One day, my cellmate pointed out the news feed that was scrolling across the bottom of the TV that he had in prison. And scrolling across there on national news so all of Turkey can read it. And I was cut off from the outside, so I didn't know what was happening. The news scroll said, "Priest Brunson to go on trial for terrorism. Prosecutors demanding life in prison." This is how I found out that I was going on trial for life in prison. I was numb with fear. That night, my reading program happened to include Psalm 118. And I read, "The Lord is my helper. I will not be afraid. What can man do to me?" I thought, what can man do to me? I can think of a lot of things that man can do to me. Fear is real. We prepare ourselves so that when we are afraid, we react not from that fear, but from the right perspective. Because if we react from fear, then the instinct is to run away. Last week I was able to see an Army Ranger assault in Fort Bragg. The reason the military is more effective than a mob is because soldiers have been trained to stand even when they're afraid. To not run when you're persecuted, to not run when you're flooded with fear, you have to have an anchor in place, something to cling to when the instinct is to give in, to run away. So I thank God that I did not have the option to run away. I'll just mention, I would read Matthew 10, where Jesus tells the disciples, "Go from one village to the other. When they persecute you in one, then flee to the other." And I was so upset. Say, "You didn't let me flee. This isn't fair." But I came to a point where I'm so grateful that God didn't give me the option of choosing whether I would suffer persecution, whether I would be in prison or not, because I probably would have run like Jonah did. And it took almost a year before I reached a point where I was consistently willing to serve God through imprisonment. In the end, I did become strong enough to stand before hostile judges, before media, and declare the supremacy of Jesus. But I went through a lot of battles to reach that point. Jesus also says that if we're not ready when persecution comes, that if it surprises us, that many will fall into drunkenness and immorality. And they'll do this as a means of escape, of self-medication. And the fourth thing he said about this is that many will be offended. I talked about this yesterday, and it is a big one. Because Jesus warned that many believers will be offended. When persecution comes, they'll be offended at what God allows. Many will be offended because in the midst of difficulties, they will think that God has abandoned them. They'll be so disappointed and so hurt that their hearts will become cold and they will turn away. So this is a time, I believe, to reset, to make sure that our foundation is solid, that we're emphasizing the right things for ourselves as leaders, but also for our congregations. So I want to talk about a couple of the things that took me through prison, that helped me to persevere. And the first is fear of God, having the right perspective. I prayed for this so much in prison. I was confident that if I had a correct perspective on God's majesty, on how awesome he is, on his power and his greatness, I was confident that I wouldn't question him and I would bear whatever was necessary. And I thought about Paul especially. He encountered the risen, glorified Jesus. It was so amazing. He gets knocked off of his horse. And then he had visions where he saw Jesus. And he visited heaven. No wonder he could talk about his sufferings from a very different perspective, that this was all a momentary light affliction compared to the glory that he would one day have. And I complained, God, you let Paul see you. Jesus, you appeared to him in all your glory. You took him to heaven. Of course he sees things from a different perspective. I want to see that way too. Let me see you. Reveal yourself to me. Show me your majesty. Let me fall like Isaiah did before you, just in awe and wonder. Let me see from a heavenly perspective. But it didn't happen. It's harder for us who don't get taken to heaven. I'm still hoping for that before I die. I'd like to see the risen Jesus. I've been praying for this for years. But until then, well, the fear of God is harder for us if we don't have those experiences. We have to work at it. But that's the point. You have to work at it. You have to seek it. You have to ask for it. And I began to pray every day, God, put your fear in my heart. Because God said, I will put the fear of me in their hearts that they may not turn from me. And the flip side of that is that if we don't have the fear of God in our hearts, then when difficulties come, we're more likely to just fade away. So ask for this fear of God. Ask God to give you this perspective on suffering, on his greatness, why he's worthy of our suffering. And don't wait for persecution to come before you do this. Do it now and teach it to your churches. Some years ago, Noreen felt an urgency to prepare for hardship. She set aside 3 weeks to focus intensely on this, and there was a fasting and just intense prayer. Why? Because she was afraid of persecution, and she still is. She wanted to be strengthened so that she could stand, because she was afraid that she wouldn't be able to stand. So she prepared. She sought God's face on this. So when this terrible ordeal started for us, no, she wasn't prepared, but she wasn't unprepared either. So when difficulties come, most likely you will be afraid. The reason God says don't fear is because the people are afraid. You can look at David. He'll say, I will not fear. Well, the psalm before that says, I'm full of fear. It's likely that you will be afraid. But what will you fear more? That's the point of the fear of God. What will you fear more? The consequences of standing before God? I'm sorry, the consequences of standing for God? Or the consequences of not standing for God? Will you care more about God's opinion or that of the Twitter mob? And the answer will depend a great deal on how much fear of God is in your heart. The second thing that was so crucial for me is actually the most important. Jesus said it was the most important thing, and that's the first commandment. I mentioned yesterday how in 2007 I started to run after God in a new way. We began to spend a lot of time just seeking God's face. I began to hunger to experience, to taste God's glory, and we set pursuing intimacy with God as our main value, hearing his voice, seeking his presence, learning to live as his sons and daughters. Everything in our lives, not just ministry, everything, relationships, how we do our jobs, it all flows out of this intimacy. If the relationship with God is right, I'm not saying everything will be easy, but everything will come into the right alignment in our lives. So by 2016, when I was arrested, I had run after God's presence for years. I had tasted his presence. I was focused on intimacy with God. But even so, prison tested my love for God. The question was, would I survive prison? And more important than surviving physically, would my heart towards God survive prison? I mentioned yesterday how at around the 9-month mark of prison, I read something that sobered me up. How the valley of testing is full of skeletons, full of the dry bones of believers who have failed their tests. And they may end up going to heaven, but they miss out on becoming what God wanted them to be, on doing what God wanted them to do. And they're believers, but they have no fruit in their lives. And I'd already lost 50 pounds. I was suicidal. I was thoroughly broken. I had given up. But when I read this, it just hit me. And I started to plead with God, I don't want to fail in the valley of testing. Don't let me fail. Shortly after this, I was moved from my overcrowded cell to a maximum security prison called Buja. And shortly after I arrived in Buja, I made a decision. Early on in my time there, there was very little I could do to fight for my freedom. But I realized it was completely up to me to fight for my relationship with God. And I thought, if I lose my intimacy, my friendship with God, if I lose my relationship with him, then I've lost everything. And I had to fight. I had to fight. I had to take the initiative, because love and devotion, intimacy and endurance, they don't happen automatically. And so I started to take deliberate steps. I told God, whatever you do or do not do, I will follow you. And I said this with a bit of defiance towards him, because I felt like he'd abandoned me and he wasn't speaking to me. And where was his strength and grace? But I said, whatever you do or don't do, I will follow you. I'm going to hold on to you. I won't let go. I won't let go. If you don't speak to me, I'll still follow you. If you don't give me your presence, I will still follow you. If you don't deliver me, I will still follow you. And this marked a turning point for me. I'd made a decision years before to run after God, to pursue him. But now I was doing it under very different, much more difficult circumstances. I was cut off from all other Christians. I prayed alone. I worshiped alone. I was alone. And I was facing life in prison. But as much as possible, I decided to focus myself on God throughout each day. It was after this that I took another step, locking away my doubts and my questions in that strong box I talked about yesterday. And my heart was broken towards God. I was deeply disappointed. I was very confused. But I fought to draw close to God. I fought to love Jesus. That's when I also started dancing as an act of obedience and love to him. I think of Jesus' message to the church of Ephesus, a site that was less than an hour from our home in Turkey. Jesus had nothing to criticize about their ministry, their devotion to truth. If you read the good things he said about them, that's what you'd want your church to be. But he did say something that was very sobering. He says, you're doing everything right. You've done everything right, except that your first love has become cold. They had a commitment to truth, but they were missing the heart of Jesus. And this should be really sobering to us especially, because we tend to focus on doctrine and theology. We're famous for right teaching, aren't we? For right belief. But the heart is actually more fundamental, and it's more elusive. Jesus said that the most important thing, the fundamental, the foundational thing, is to love God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength. You know the verse. To love him with all that you are. This love is what will make you willing to stand for Jesus, to pay the price. It'll make you willing to persevere, to endure. And it seems so obvious. It's so simple. Jesus told us it's the most important thing. And yet somehow, many of us still miss it. Loving God includes feelings, but it's more than this. It's devotion. It's obedience. It's pursuit. And it doesn't happen automatically. When I was a younger man, I was sure that when I was older, that I would be really deeply spiritual and in love with God. And I do love God. I do. But it didn't happen automatically. It didn't happen just because I got older. And many people start out with passion for God. You've seen it. They start out with that zeal for him, passion. But very few pursue God long term in this way. Some of my close friends are no longer walking with the Lord. And some who are still believers, they don't have passion for God. They don't have passion for Jesus. Many pastors drop out of ministry because of spiritual burnout. It's likely that some of you here in this room are going to drop out of ministry if you don't get a grip on this. If you don't get a grip on this issue. I had to pursue. And the problem is that I keep sliding. This is our natural tendency. We naturally decrease in love. We don't naturally increase, we naturally decrease. So it has to be nurtured. So I urge you, ask for this every day. If you're not hungry, ask God to make you hungry. I have to continue to renew my pursuit. I am so glad not to be in prison. I am so glad to have escaped prison. But there's something I miss from that terrible ordeal. The conditions of my imprisonment, the isolations, the threats, the fear, they really tested me. But they also drove me to cling to God as never before. They brought a rare clarity about what really matters. And my everyday in prison became consumed with seeking God, with drawing close to him. And it was a matter of spiritual survival for me. And now I'm free. I'm so grateful for my freedom. But I miss being so completely dependent on God. I want to recapture that desperate seeking I had then. I'll give you an example of where it took me. One day in prison, I was reading Philippians. I read Philippians and 2 Timothy a lot. I'm reading Philippians, and a verse in chapter 2 suddenly leapt out at me. And Paul says there, everyone seeks their own interests and not the interests of Jesus Christ. Everyone seeks their own interests and not the interests of Jesus Christ. And I'd read this so many times, and somehow I'd never noticed it. But I realized Paul was describing me. I had been so focused on my interests. What were my interests? To get out of prison, to get back to my children and my wife. I'd been so focused on what I wanted. But what about the interests of Jesus? What if his interests were best served by my remaining in prison? I started to weep. I didn't have the interests of Jesus at heart. And I wept and I asked for forgiveness, for the strength, the will to seek his interests rather than my own. So since I'm urging you to prepare yourself, to prepare your church for persecution, to stand in difficulty, let me make it very simple. A lover will endure much more than a servant. A lover is willing to suffer for his beloved. But God has many servants, but few lovers. The third point is perseverance. And this was the message of Jesus. I hadn't realized how much he emphasized it until I read the New Testament in prison. And I kept running into these verses that emphasize that I must endure to the end, that I must finish the race well, that I must overcome. And I didn't like that message. I wanted to hear, I'll never let you go. You will be faithful to the end because I'll make you faithful. But that's God's side. On my side, I kept hearing that, seeing these verses. Oh, I have to endure. I have to hold on. I have to persevere. I must overcome. Years ago, someone was praying for me, hearing from God, trying to hear from God for me, and said, Andrew, you will be known for perseverance. And I said, oh, no. I'd rather be known for miracles or for, you know, hosting the presence of God or, you know, great ministry, not perseverance. But when I was failing in prison, then I began to pray fervently, yes, God, give me this impartation of perseverance. Pour perseverance into me. Give me endurance. We know perseverance is important, but how do we develop it? I think we just need to do it. There's no easy answer. There's no shortcut. We need to teach it. We need to underline how important it is, and then we just need to do it. And there's God's side of this. Without his grace, I couldn't have made it. He must give me the grace to persevere. But if that's the only thing we're teaching, our people will not be ready. Because there's also my side that I have to cooperate with God's grace. I made decisions with my will. I repented of wrong words. I chose life, even when I wanted suicide, I wanted death. I chose life. I battled, even when I was weary, when I was worn out. And I gave up. I failed. I was broken. But then I went back to the battle again. And I don't say this to highlight my strength. I hope I've been transparent with my weakness. I come with a testimony of weakness and God's strength. But I'm saying this because I want to emphasize that we have a choice. It may be difficult. It may be more than I can handle. I may be quavering with fear, but I have a choice to make. Do I keep looking to God, or do I look away? Do I keep serving the interests of Jesus, or do I serve my own? It was fear of God and love for God that fueled my perseverance. I'll wrap up now. Yesterday, I explained how I came to write my song, Worthy of My All. Towards the end of my first year in prison, I was called in and told that to a court session, I was charged with attempting to overthrow the Turkish government, military espionage, all those things, and it was an automatic 3 life sentences with no parole and solitary confinement. This meant I wouldn't get out. I wouldn't see my children again. I'd be separated from my wife. I'd waste away in a Turkish prison for the rest of my life. And I've been climbing upwards. I just talked about some of those things. I've been climbing upwards out of brokenness. I'd made that decision to pursue God no matter what, but this really knocked me down hard. And it was around 2 weeks after this that I wrote this song. The verse I wanted to emphasize is this, because it's really the core to me. I want to be found worthy to stand before you on that day with no regrets from cowardice, things left undone. To hear you say, well done, my faithful friend. Now enter your reward. Jesus, my joy, you are the prize I'm running for. And this became my main prayer. I want to live in such a way that I have no regrets when I stand before Jesus. I sang this every day for the rest of my time in prison. Regrets in heaven? Are there regrets in heaven? Certainly we won't live under a weight of regret. But where each of us will stand before Jesus, and yes, I think there are people who will have regret. Because to some, he's going to say, you're saved, but you wasted your life. There were victories I intended for you to win. You missed out on them because you ran away from the battle. There was an inheritance that I planned for you, but you pulled back. There was a reward, but you forfeited that reward. This was an important turnaround for me because earlier on at a very low point, I had given it up. I'd renounced it. I'd put 23 years of investment into Turkey, and I said, Lord, I just renounced my inheritance. I can't handle this anymore. Just let me go home to my family. I'm willing to be the least in the kingdom of heaven, the least in heaven. I don't care about rewards and any plans that you had for me. I give them up. I renounce them. Just let me go home because I cannot handle this anymore. But I'd come to the point where I say, no. No, I repent of this. I want everything that you have planned for me. I want every one of your plans to come true. I don't want to miss out on any of them. I don't want to stand before you and for you to show me, Andrew, these are the victories I had for you. These are the things I planned. But you didn't do them. You gave up in prison. You ran because you were a coward. So I began to fight every day to bring myself to a point of submission where I embraced the assignment that he gave me. You can be sure I didn't want to be in prison, but I wanted to be willing. I said, Lord, I want to embrace your assignment, even if it means remaining in prison, because I'd gained a small measure of the fear of God. My love for Jesus had been tested and grown. He'd given me a different perspective, more of an eternal perspective, and this drove me. If I love Jesus, then I'll be willing to stand for him, even if it costs me. If I love Jesus, I'll obey him, even if it costs me. Because I love Jesus, I will serve his purposes. Because I love Jesus, I will not be ashamed of him. Because I love Jesus, I will pursue him. When I wake up in the morning, I try to start off my day by saying this: the only thing that matters is what my King, Jesus Christ, thinks of me and what he says about me. Nothing else can compare. There's nothing that's more important than this. To be faithful in my generation, to love him, to stand unashamed, without apology for my King. This is what I can do, and it is what I must do. And someday you will also stand before King Jesus. May you do so without cause for regret. I don't know what exactly to do, but I think that God wants to meet with a number of you. As I've been speaking on one of these subjects, maybe something stirred in your heart. Some of you have something stirring in your heart. Maybe you don't have that fear of God and you realize now that you need it. Or you need to renew your commitment to devotion, to the first commandment, to make the most important thing, the most important thing in your life. Maybe you need that impartation of perseverance to prepare the way that Noreen did, take this very seriously and say, I want to take a step. I want to declare that I'm taking this seriously before you, God, that I want to prepare. Maybe you're afraid that you'll be a coward and run, or you've been tempted to compromise. Oh, we need to get ready. So for those of you whom God is speaking to, I invite you to stand and take a solemn step towards God and ask him for what you need, because I believe that he is ready to give it. He wants to give impartations of intimacy, of hunger, of thirst for him, of courage, of endurance, of perseverance, of heavenly vision, of fear of God. Ask it from him. Lord, put your fear in my heart, that my heart might be divided, but that it be brought together into unity with fear of you. Put your fear in my heart so that I will not depart from you. Lord God, I pray over those who are standing for, I don't know what reason, that's between you and them, but I pray now, Holy Spirit, for an impartation of perseverance. What you gave to me, Lord God, that enabled me to endure. Lord, I ask now for an impartation of perseverance to my brothers and sisters who are going to stand in difficulty. Give them courage now to stand unapologetically for you, Jesus. Put your fear in our hearts, that we would fear you more than man, that we would fear the consequences of not standing for you much more than what man could do to us. Put your fear in our hearts that we stand and not run, that we live for your approval and care not what man thinks of us. Oh, Lord God, prepare these men and women. Prepare them. Prepare us. Raise up dread warriors, people who will stand in spite of fear. Raise up devoted lovers, lovers who are willing to suffer for their beloved. May they stand unashamed of you, Jesus. May they be found worthy to stand before you on that day with no regrets. May none of the plans you have for them fall to the ground. Lord, prepare these leaders to prepare their churches so that their churches stand firm in the storm, so that their people will not be ashamed of you. I want to pray over you the prayer that I prayed in prison for myself and for my family so many times. Father God, pour out on your sons and daughters the courage, the strength, the confidence, the perseverance, the endurance, and steadfastness of Jesus. Pour all of Jesus into us, your sons and daughters, that we may run the race set before us and finish well, a beautiful bride, purified in the fires of faithful obedience, tested and found worthy of her beloved, of Jesus, the King of glory. Amen.